Hello and welcome to another edition of Now You Know. I'm your host, Dale Wilson. Now You Know is a public affairs show filmed right here in Port Angeles. We try to get in the movers and shakers and candlestick makers and everyone who makes a difference in Port Angeles and Clallam County. Today we have a very special guest and actually some breaking news here. Our guest today is our county treasurer, Selinda Barkuis. Selinda, welcome and thanks for coming in to Now You Know.
Thanks for having me, Dale.
And the breaking news, and it broke on me just a few minutes ago, so tell the people what you have to share.
Well, what I told Commissioner Randy Johnson today and Commissioner Mark Ozias yesterday on my staff yesterday is that I'm working on leaving the position of county treasurer. I've had enough, and I need to take time out to take care of myself and my health, and so I told him that we need to start working on that transition.
So you're 2 years into your second term.
Yes.
And you came in unopposed on this second term.
Yes.
And from what I gather, this job is taking its toll on you.
Yes, it has been a very, very difficult 6 years as county treasurer. And things have happened to me during that time that at times didn't make sense, especially when they came from the prosecutor. But what I learned last year with the Lang settlement is that the prosecutor has apparently had an issue very personally with me and my opinions and my work at the county, because he at that point in 2007, which prompted the Lang lawsuit, redacted an email that I wrote, which had an opinion that was consistent with the state attorney general and ecology that he didn't like. And so he had one of his deputy prosecutors, we're talking about Prosecutor Mark Nichols.
Okay.
At that time, he was a deputy prosecutor. So he didn't like my opinion, and he...
All right, now let me take the viewers back with us for a little bit. Before you were county treasurer, you worked in the planning department for the community development office, is that correct?
Yes, I was a senior planner.
So that's when you had the occasion to write this opinion.
Yes, thank you. Yes, I was tasked by my immediate supervisor at the time, Steve Gray, and he just gave me a little research subject. I don't think it had any name attached to it. Could you research this particular question? And I did. As you know, I'm a licensed attorney. Although I was working at the time as a senior planner, not as a lawyer, and I was not holding myself out as a lawyer. But he was asking me to do a little research project, which I did, and I sent him that answer. And he did then his own research in an email then that he forwarded my email to Mark Nichols, and he had added his own opinion that, you know, he had reached out to the Department of Ecology and that I was right.
All right, let's take the viewers back again, too, on the Lang situation. And this started, I think, back in 1997.
Yes.
Where Scott Lang had owned property out at Clallam Bay, and he was interested in buying a lot that was across the street from his home. And everyone told him that it's a lot that you can never build on.
And he actually bought that in, that was in 90. Did you say 97?
Yeah.
Okay, because the email was in 2007. I'm
right.
Sorry. Okay.
But he wanted to purchase a lot to make sure that he would always have an unobstructed view, and everybody told him that the lot was not one that could be built upon, could never be developed under county ordinances at the time, and so he did not buy it for that reason. And then it was a vacation place that he had out there. He came home for a vacation, or came back to his place for vacation, and realized somebody was building or developing the lot across there. And that's when he started attempting to find out how they got this permit to build a lot. And I think that's where you came in to...
I didn't come in until 2007. So the way I understand the chronology is that at the time, that was all the late 1990s. And that's where I came involved was in 2007. There had been a storm, I think it was in 2006, which had eroded the beach. So he knew there had been a house built there, and he was already up in arms about it. But that storm revealed that there had also been a bulkhead put in. And that bulkhead, because of the wave action resulting associated with the bulkhead, had eroded a lot that he had bought. So then he had been damaged. The bulkhead also was damaged, and the Siebelacks, who owned that property, went in for a permit at that time in 2007, I believe, or maybe late 2006, to get that bulkhead repaired. And then the question arose, because Mr. Lane at that point had figured out, well, they're using that property, the Siebelacks, they're using it as a rental. So, and the law on the Shoreline Management Act has a specific section in there that was applicable to this permit application that limited it to, I believe it was lessees. Mm-hmm. And the question was, well, if lessees can rebuild, can lessors? And I'm like, well, if the law is specific and says lessees, then presumably that means not lessors. I mean, it's one of those legal constructions, you know. If they specify this and leave out that, then apparently they mean this.
So it's a good idea to have a lawyer in the planning office at that time.
Well, so that's what I wrote back, and that's what I said, that, you know, and then I found a case that seemed to be on point. So I just did this little research that said, well, if it says lessees, it's lessees. And so the civil acts, though, were lessors. And in any event, this little opinion went to Mark Nichols. Mark Nichols didn't like it.
Mark Nichols was at that time the deputy prosecuting attorney.
He apparently didn't, and that was the last, by the way, that I had heard of this email until 2016.
Now, is that opinion that you wrote one of the papers that was found in the box downstairs?
No, this email was the cause, though, of that lawsuit, because it was that email that, because Mark Nichols then instructed his deputy prosecutor at the time to write a different legal opinion that said, oh, well, you know, lessors, they can still, they can basically allowing the Siebel Acts to go forward. Mr. Lang was suing the Siebel Acts. So he had received his opinion, basically says, well, you know, you're wrong, and we say this, so he was suing his neighbors at that time, and he was doing public records requests with the county. So my email
was to buttress his case,
right, and to find more information to help him in his case against his neighbor. And the county was withholding. Well, actually, they forwarded this email, but my entire email was redacted out, and parts of my supervisor's email had been redacted out. And anyway, it was years later that they did send him this email, and he realized how important that email had been and how much it had harmed him that hadn't come out. And that's when he filed suit. It was on that email. So
Now that's when he filed the Public Records Act suit?
Suit, yes. Okay. There were three lawsuits, you're
okay,
right.
So let's take our viewers with us. There's
right.
three lawsuits all
right.
together.
Yeah, so
one was for the misuse of the property,
yes.
or misuse of rebuilding the bulkhead.
One was against his neighbor for rebuilding and building.
Right.
So one was against the neighbor for damaging his property because of their bulkhead.
Right.
And one was against the county trying to force them to take code compliance actions against the neighbor. Mm-hmm. And under a code compliance title that I had written and had been enacted while I was a senior planner. I didn't know this lawsuit actually went to the appeals court and back over this code compliance title that I wrote, and I never knew anything about it. I was being the treasurer, they were doing all of this here. I had no idea. But along the way, I had been contacted by the prosecuting attorney's office for certain materials, and I actually have emails going back to 2013 where I also say, and there is a box, and there is a box. And it wasn't
By that you mean a box of records?
Box of records that
are being requested by the public records request.
Well, I didn't see the public records request, but by what they were asking me for,
you
I
knew
said,
there was
well,
supplemental
there,
data
yes,
somewhere.
There is, well, there is, yes, there is this binder, and then there is a box. And apparently they never went after that box. And they never went into my online directory, you know, my work directory when I was working for DCD. To which I no longer had access, but you know, I was still in the courthouse. IT has access to everything. So anyway, when we fast forward now to when they were trying to settle this lawsuit last year, and I got wind of it.
This is the Lang settlement.
The Lang settlement, you know, the
$500,000 taxpayer money went out.
$500,000, all because the prosecutor felt the need to redact my email, and that's what the key issue was. For, you know, that drove this. But they also hit this box, so they never found it, and they blamed it then on, ooh, we found this box in 2016. Well, I've been telling them about this box in 2013. So, and not only one email, but several emails. I specifically sent an email at one time that says, hey, if there's public records requests, I'd be happy to help.
And did they ever ask you for that help?
No.
So, and that box that was found, that much of it was responsive to Scott Lang's public records request, and some people have said that there was probably $1 million or $2 million worth of fines and fees that could have been extracted from the county.
Oh, yeah.
Had Lane decided to, because they pay $5 a page per day,
and
that it's not
right.
tendered.
And if he had found out that I had actually been sending emails telling him about this box, and so they purposefully withheld this box from him for all these years. They purposefully withheld my work directory. They completely eradicated, annihilated my work product for 6 years in the basement.
Now let me be sure I hear you saying that you feel like that the county prosecutor was purposely obstructing the release of these materials.
Yes.
And
so in any event, that issue, I think, the fact that he redacted me in 2007, and you remember the whole thing with the warrants, where they felt he wrote a legal opinion that, again, trumped my opinion. At the time, it made no sense. Why are they doing this? You know, it seems so silly. But now I realize that he was sucked in by the county administrator because he went, well, you trumped her over there.
Okay, you're taking the audience a little bit faster. Okay, and now what you're talking about is when
the million dollar
County Commissioner Jim McIntyre asked for $1 million from the county's opportunity fund to give to the port.
He authorized the auditor to cut a $1 million check to the port.
And this was no strings attached, no contract
no
involved.
Strings, this no proper
a
budget.
A gift of taxpayer money to the port.
Out of reserves, because they refused to do a budget emergency process.
Now, did this come out of the reserves or out of opportunity fund?
Well, it was opportunity fund reserves.
Okay.
It was what we call ending fund balance reserves, meaning it's unappropriated public funds. It's supposed to stay in the treasury that year. That's what that means to me as a treasurer. This money is supposed to stay. It's ending fund balance reserves. Well, they authorized the auditor to cut a check and send it out. And I'm like, no, you need to appropriate these funds. Interesting enough, in this week's agenda summary packet, the agenda packet to the board, there was a legal opinion by Dave Alvarez on whether
the deputy county prosecutor.
Yes, who because you probably heard about the $900,000 grant request from the housing authority.
Yes.
Out of opportunity fund, and there's a legal opinion in there where Dave Alvarez is saying the deputy prosecutor, and yes, you do have to do a budget emergency, and refers to what I went through as brouhaha. But it's like, well, you just do, you know, agree with me.
So they're
and
changing
so now
the
rules? Now you're trumping your boss's opinion, which previously trumped mine.
So they're changing the rules depending on who's making the ask.
Well, I think they realize that they don't. What I advised the commissioners early on this year, I gave them a memo, the first business meeting of the year, that says, you know, this has serious implications. I think you need to get an attorney general opinion. And they don't want to get an attorney general opinion, so they realize, well, maybe we should just basically tell them the truth, because we don't want this to go to the attorney general.
Folks, we've got a lot more. We're going to take a break, and we'll be right back with our special guest, the County Treasurer Selinda Barkuis, and some very interesting breaking news. We'll be right back. And hello, welcome back. I'm Dale Wilson for Now You Know. Our special guest today is Clallam County Treasurer Selinda Barkuis. And Selinda has shared with us some pretty interesting breaking news today. Selinda has decided to turn in her resignation after 6 years in the...
I haven't submitted it
yet.
I beg your pardon. I want to make very clear on that. And working on leaving.
You're working on leaving. Okay, so there's a high probability that you may be departing the office.
Yes, but I have not quite set a date. I want to make sure that the transition is done in as responsibly and
thanks
as
for
possible.
Correcting me on that. What brings you to this decision, Selinda?
Because it's just a never-ending battle against the threats, you know, against the Treasury. And a lot of these threats, you know, you expect the usual threats from the outside, fraudulent warrants, people doing imposter fraud, but a lot of the threats, many of the threats are coming from within the county courthouse itself. And
now, when you say inside the courthouse,
well, because we're talking about the county administrator who has Jim Jones, who's 4 years rendered his may or may not be correct legal opinions and interpretations of law and fact, and that make it a lot more difficult for me to keep the money safe than it should be.
Okay, let's talk about some of that. I know that you were pressured at one time to loan to the city of Port Angeles $6 or $8 million.
$8 million, yes.
And then you turned them down, decided it was not a good investment.
Right, but in the process, and I had written a memo, which I had just read into the record, because I knew it wouldn't make it as part of the record. So I read it into the record, and then I explained to detail why I wouldn't make that loan, couldn't make that loan. It would be have been grossly unlawful, and I could have been held personally liable for it if the city had defaulted. And you know, this is money, I want to back up with that, because the reserve funds are there for a rainy day. You know, these funds are there, so when the big one hits, $8 million he wanted me to loan out of the general road and capital funds reserves. Well, those are exactly the reserves we're going to need when the big one hits.
And you mean the earthquake?
The earthquake or a storm. And at that point, you know, the city is just as likely to need its money as the county. I mean, and so at that point, I would have had to explain to the people, the taxpayers of Clallam County, yes, I know it says $8 million here in this piece of paper in reserves, but that's really an account receivable and we don't actually have that money. So $8 million worth of road repair won't be able to be made. And then, you know, I'm pretty sure there would have been some very upset people who would have said, why did you loan that money out when it's so specific in the law that I shall not loan? But Jim Jones, on the record, made the announcement, pronounced on the front page of the Peninsula Daily News, ever so useful, that it was in the commissioner's sole discretion to decide whether to loan out reserve funds.
Now that's where he interpreted the attorney general's opinion.
Yes, that's where he pretended to quote from an attorney general opinion, but he added words twice in two different spaces that completely changed the outcome of the attorney general opinion. It was talking about making loans between funds that stay within the treasury. Mm-hmm. So this money is not leaving the treasury.
Now let's make sure the people understand that the county treasurer is liable personally. For so if you had made a bad investment, whether it was Quaker Oats or the city of Port Angeles, and it turned out to be a bad investment, then you're responsible for replacing that
right
fund.
And we had a treasurer, and he's still alive, Bob Clark, three treasurers back, who made a bad investment. He did it unknowingly. He didn't know he was making a bad investment. A lot of municipalities were investing in the same outfit or through the same outfit, but it turned out to be a bad investment, and he ended up being sued for personal liability for $1 million. And they spent 4 years from hell defending against that. And he only won on appeals 2-1. It was no slam dunk.
So the trial jury found against him, and he appealed it.
The appeals court held him not liable 2-1. I'm not sure actually what the trial court did. I just have the appeals court decision. 2-1 that he shouldn't be held personally.
So you had every right to be very, very cautious.
And there's another treasurer right now, an ex-treasurer in Kittitas County. He was sued last year for a failure to aggressively collect taxes. So the buck stops with the treasurer. And it seems to me, and this is one of the reasons I got to leave, because it's like there's people, $400 an hour tax attorneys, you know, Nippon mentioned five of them, that apparently try to figure out how to stiff.
Okay, so let me be sure the people can appreciate what that. As treasurer, you have to determine the personal.
I collect. I don't
you
determine.
Collect taxes, excuse me. You collect taxes on the personal property of individuals and corporations and companies doing business in Clallam County. Yeah. Okay, now. I think what spooked you a little bit, from my understanding, is when a couple of businesses went out of business on the West End, some property that was there and was supposed to stay there while they went through transition somehow disappeared and they didn't get the taxes on it. Is that correct?
Now we're talking about the Interfor sites in Forks.
Right.
When So whoever owns the personal property on January 1st of 2016 owes the taxes that become due in 2017. And so there is this lag of time.
Uh-huh.
And there is in the law, if you sell your personal property taxes, you have to pay ahead. You have to pay advance taxes to make sure that, you know, because once you sell the personal property then you still owe the taxes if you owned it on January 1st, that become due the next year. So those taxes were not remitted to the county treasurer as they should have been. And so this becomes interesting because on the one hand, treasurers can be sued for aggressively failing to collect, but wait a minute, what about these taxpayers that are refusing to send in the money? You know, there's statutes about that too, but that's just making my point that the buck stops with the treasurer. You know, so everybody else gets away with, gee, not quite following the law, but boy, if the treasurer. And so anyway, what we're looking for is a new treasurer that is willing to assume all of these responsibilities and liabilities. And that is going to be the commissioner's job, because I don't want to do this anymore. And not under these circumstances, not with a prosecutor who obviously has serious issues with me going back to 2007. And, you know, already has several judgments against him now.
All right, let's talk a little bit about a couple other things that I would imagine help get you to this point. Your county prosecutor filed suit against you, seemingly representing the daily paper.
Yes.
So talk about that a little bit.
Well, so interestingly enough, and while the Lang settlement negotiations were going on, very confidentially apparently, they were threatening me. The prosecutor's office was threatening me to sue me because Paul Gottlieb of the Peninsula News had submitted a public records request looking for my emails out of my personal account to you, if you remember.
Now, this is back when you were writing articles for
a local publication. Right. And they were looking for my emails that I'd written from my personal account, my capacity as treasurer, to you. And it's like, well, what sort of governmental business are we conducting? You know, if we're not talking about your taxes, then we're not conducting governmental business. But they were clearly harassing and intimidating me because you had just declared me whistleblower of the year.
No, that was person of the year.
Person of the year, right, for my whistleblowing. Okay. And in any event, so I had written Paul Gottlieb an email back that said I have no responsive documents because I don't, you know, I use my personal email exclusively for political and personal emails. And all my governmental, you know, and it's interesting because I had sent the emails I sent you from my business email. Well, then I was using my business email for political reasons. You could have sued me for that. But now I'm using my personal email. Oh, well, they're suing me for that.
Okay, so my understanding is that the daily paper wanted to get a copy of all of your official emails, but also wanted you to scrub your personal devices to make sure that you didn't have any business emails on there.
Right, and they had actually, the letter they sent me when they got this public records request, what I heard, I heard about it, I got a certified letter at my home address that said, turn over all the public records in your possession, because you've been the lucky winner of a public records request, and we need to get all your public records that you might have in your possession so we can go through them and redact.
Now, this certified letter came from?
This came from the commissioner's office.
From the county?
Yes.
Okay, and so you supplied them all of the records that they had requested, all that was due them, and then you got sued.
I didn't supply, they had access to my email, so they got whatever, my governmental email. Mm-hmm. But my personal email, I said, I don't have any responsive documents. I sent this email to Paul Gottlieb directly, and I did not CC the commissioner's office.
Paul Gottlieb is a reporter for the Daily Paper.
Yes, and I emailed him and said, I have no responsive documents, but if you have any questions, let me know. Email me. And he never emailed me. Then I met him in the hallway a few weeks later. I was talking to somebody there. I saw Paul Gottlieb. I'm like, hey, Paul.
In the hallway at the courthouse.
Did you get my email? And can we talk about this public records request? And he says, no, I don't want to talk about it. And he walked off. And then I got sued.
Okay, so now the county prosecutor's
office.
But
the interesting thing is, I think the reason they were suing me, because remember this was at the same time that they were doing the Lang negotiation, is that they could then, you know, marry my name to that $500,000 settlement. They knew they were going to pay the settlement, and they needed to blame somebody. And so by suing me, I'm now the one being sued for public records, and that made it into the.
They're hoping that the people
and
will.
So,
the public that is not completely tuned in will conflate this in the mind that you got sued, and then there was a $500,000 payoff.
And that it was my fault.
And going to hang it on you. All right, and the fact of the matter is.
And it was very specifically the fault of.
The fact of the matter is, you supplied them, or the county supplied them with all of the emails.
Yes.
And were responsive to the request, but then they weren't satisfied that they had everything, so the county prosecutor filed a writ of mandamus.
Right, and so I was emailing with the commissioner's office, and the commissioner's office was threatening to refer this to the prosecutor's office, and I said, well, I emailed back and said, you need a majority of commissioners before you can submit it to the prosecutor. I never heard back. That's when I got sued. And so since that time, I showed up, I got served with the paperwork in my office by a sheriff's deputy in front of my staff, got served with this paperwork.
So intimidation, embarrassment?
Intimidation. And just, and it was, you know, they were looking for personal liability. That I assume all personal liability, I would be personally defend against this lawsuit. Here is the prosecutor doing the dirty work for the Peninsula Daily News.
But wait, the prosecutor is supposed to be your attorney.
Yes, he is supposed to be my attorney.
So that your attorney sued you.
Yes.
And did they supply you with an attorney?
No, they refused. I asked for an attorney to help me in this, and they refused.
So you were hung out to dry.
Yes.
All by yourself. And it sounds like that the prosecutor was representing the daily paper.
Yes.
Instead of you and the county.
Right.
At the time.
Yes.
How does that come about, legally speaking? How does that
Well,
happen?
I'm not really sure they have, you know, the prosecutor has standing to do this. I think he went well outside of his authorities to do this, in my opinion.
So
I think he went well past his authority.
So the county commissioners finally realized that this is a little foolish for the...
Well, so I showed up on Monday work session, and I'm like, hey guys, why did you sue me? And the three commissioners go,
who sued you?
I didn't agree to sue you. I didn't agree to sue you. That's what Chapman says. Well, I didn't agree to sue you. I didn't agree to sue you. They didn't know that I was going to be sued. And so they decided right then and there that they should be dismissed. And that became a whole different story because the prosecutor didn't really want to dismiss it, then claimed that there were lawyers involved on behalf of the Peninsula Daily News. I've done public records requests, and there were no lawyers on behalf of the Peninsula Daily News. I mean, so
the only one representing the Peninsula Daily News was our county prosecutor.
Yes, there was no, there were no letters from lawyers threatening this, that, or the other thing. I asked, you know, well, show me these letters then. What was the county being threatened with? There is nothing from any lawyer. And here is the county prosecutor on video. I have these videos from the work session claiming that, ooh, there's these lawyers, and these lawyers are threatening this. And so they somehow, though, the prosecutor convinced the commissioners I should be sued based on nothing.
There's more to come, folks. We're going to take a short break, and we're going to come back and try to get to the bottom of this. And thank you for watching this. Now you know, your host, Dale Wilson, and our special guest today is Selinda Barkuis, the county treasurer. We've got a lot more to cover, so do come back. Hello and welcome back to Now You Know. I'm your host, Dale Wilson. Our special guest today is Selinda Barkuis, the Clallam County Treasurer. And there's some really breaking news today. So far, we've discovered that Selinda Barkuis is contemplating, very seriously contemplating, removing herself from her position as the Clallam County Treasurer. She's been on the job 6 years. She is halfway through her second term. And due to a lot of pressures, unnecessary pressures at the courthouse, being redacted from opinions that were drawn up, being sued by the county prosecutor, that would seem like enough to force anybody out of office, but there may be more. Let's get back with our conversation with Selinda. Selinda, we were talking about, before the break, we were talking about the lawsuit where you were filed, the county filed a lawsuit against you, and seemingly in support of the daily paper's attempt to get your personal emails and records. And my question to you is, Paul Gottlieb is the one who filed this request, and I know he's a professional at this public records thing. And I think he probably respects you as a professional. So with him going after your personal records, do you think he was a dupe for the county or a willing dupe?
I am not really sure. I do know that the Peninsula Daily News has been no friend of mine. You know, you remember, in addition to some of the things we talked about, one of the commissioners, Commissioner Peach, you know, if you remember, during that whole $1.3 million in grants, giveaway grants, $1 million to the port, $300,000 to the city of Port Angeles, you know, I was getting threatened with criminal allegations by Commissioner Peach. And I was also getting those same threats, or they felt like threats, in emails from another Peninsula Daily News reporter. I mean, it's been a number of Peninsula Daily News reporters that have,
Well, some of the emails
not help my, you know.
Some of the emails that I saw that came from one of the reporters was actually threatening you,
right,
with criminal. I mean,
right, felony for just holding on. But you know, those same threats actually came from my own civil deputy prosecutor at the time. who told me that, yes, you know, holding the money to the, that is now, that the port is entitled to in the treasury, while I determine whether I'm dispersing it legally, as I'm supposed to do, that by keeping it in the treasury in the same, in the meantime, where I felt it was safe, that was misappropriation of funds.
So keeping taxpayer money
in the county treasury while deciding that, you know, to make sure it's being dispersed legally is now called misappropriation.
Did you suggest that giving away $1 million, no strings attached, without any contract whatsoever, might be misappropriation
of
contract?
I did point out that if they were going to do it this way, if you remember on the front page of the protocol, I did point out that that would come with personal liability by the people that are incurring this expense. And from where I'm sitting, of course, you know, it's personal, but from where I'm sitting, being a lawyer and reading the law, it's like Commissioner McIntyre and Commissioner Peach were determined to make this money leave the treasury outside of this law that specifically says if you don't follow this law, you can be held personally liable. So for the life of me, I don't understand why they insisted on making these disbursements and assume this personal liability potentially for $1.3 million.
Folks, full disclosure now, as you may have guessed, I do publish the Port-A-Call, a monthly news magazine, and that's why some of this was personal between Selinda and I. Selinda was a author and contributing writer for several articles back last summer. So. Whenever you are faced with the county, the weight of the county coming down on you, how do you deal with it? How do you deal with it personally?
Well, I don't sleep. I will be awake all night. This is why I have to leave. I have giant panic attacks. I don't sleep, and I do wake up in the middle of the night. I mean, it's the last thing I think about when I go to bed. It's the first thing I think about when I wake up. So what are they going to do to me today? Because it seems like every other day, there is another threat that seems to come from within the county where they're just trying to. And you know, life's too short.
What do you think is the end game? I mean, if this is
the end game is to get me out of office, or to just intimidate me completely into. And this is one of the reasons where the frustration, which is wearing on my body, is that, you know, I want to say no, but slowly but surely they have worn that out. Where I'm finding that it's easier maybe not to say no, but then I become complicit with what they're doing,
but
and
now,
I refuse to do that.
If you were playing ball, they wouldn't want you out of office. They'd be fine. So my question is, what is their end game with perhaps the next treasurer? What do you think is, you think that they just want to have full access to the county treasury without anybody standing in their way?
I can't answer the question of what it's going to look like with the next treasurer. It will be very interesting to see.
What advice would you give to the next treasurer?
Don't take the job.
What does the job pay?
It is, I think, just over $80,000 a year.
Okay, and what sort of background or resume would one need to become a county
treasurer? Well, it's going to be up to the county commissioners to find a replacement, because my understanding at this point, none of my staff wants the job. They've seen what it looks like. They don't want it. And it's very important to me that in leaving, the part of the transition is to make sure that, you know, I do want to do whatever I can to take care of the office, especially my staff. I care deeply about my staff, care deeply about the county. But,
right,
you know,
let's
become untenable for me to stay.
Let's talk about staff. You have made suggestions that you cannot get the full complement of staff,
right,
which you need to do your job, and yet other departments.
Well, and case in point. So I have been asking for staff and staff and staff, and I've been and when I do get staff, before I know it, then the county hires my staff away. I train them, they hire them away, and I start all over. So right now I have two newbie staff, and I'm very new staff, and I'm very happy with my new staff. But already I'm feeling there's noises being made about, oh, and we're going to take that one because we like that one. So. But in the meantime, though, here's the county crying poverty. $1.5 million budget, structural budget problem. And I don't think anybody's pointed out to the commissioners yet that, well, you do realize that since 2014, the prosecutor has gone from 14 full-time equivalent staff positions to 24, which is $1 million extra a year. You think that might have something to do with the $1 million, you know,
well,
million
what about
five?
What about the $1.3 million that they gave away,
well,
to the
there's
port?
Well, there's the year before. Last year was $1 million extra in staff. Oh, and then the $500,000 that went out on Lang. There's another $500,000 and a half. And then there is all these other lawyer fees that are leaving. You know, there's all these other legal fees, all these other claims that are hanging out there. Lawyers being paid for what? And they're all being hired by or for the benefit of Mark Nichols. So he's gotten 10 new people, 9 new people, and in a time when he was suing me, threatening to sue me, sending all these threatening letters. So is that why he's getting staff?
So the county prosecutor's office can get 9 or 10 new personnel and you can get none?
Right. I mean, that's what it's been like. So I have, I was able to get a half FTE a couple of years ago, and I've had to fight to keep that.
And so when you do get somebody in and you get them trained, then they'll be hired out?
Yes, they offered me, finally, after many years, they offered me, and it was an interesting timing, and it's all part of this sordid story, but at one point they offered me the staff. I had been asking for years, and I knew, oh, well, you know, yeah, they're going to give me the staff, but, you know. And so I trained, and I hired this person, great person, we worked, you know, and we were cross-training, because I knew I was going to have a staff retirement, which is happening.
And yours is
month.
A pretty specialized office.
Yes,
it's not
very,
just office work. It's,
you know,
it's specialized.
We do very, very esoteric public finance type stuff. So in any event, the day before Thanksgiving, and I had told one of the commissioners, watch, something will happen the day before Thanksgiving, because something happened the day before Thanksgiving a year ago, and sure as heck, they hired this person away from me and did it in such a way that she had to give notice the day before Thanksgiving. She came into my office, was very apologetic, says, but I have to give you notice today, the day before Thanksgiving.
Which means you've got 4 less days of that notice period to try and find somebody new.
That too, but you know, the timing, they, you know, Jim Jones is very good at
timing.
So
you think they're trying to ruin your holidays?
Oh yeah, absolutely, no questions about it. There is a nice little record
That's
of that.
That's diabolical.
Diabolical.
You think that Jim Jones is so diabolical that he will plan these things around your holidays to ruin your holiday?
Yes.
Ouch.
I do.
Again, what sort of, okay, pretend that you have decided to leave the office and you're doing an exit interview with, say, a couple of the county commissioners. What do you want them to know about the...
That they need, you know, as commissioners, the commissioners have the power of spending of the purse, the power of the purse. And it's through the power of the purse that they set county policy. That is how they implement their strategic goals, whatever they are. And right now, what the policy is that they're implementing is they will buy Nichols, whatever lawyers and whatever, and pay off his claims. And it's like, but what are you paying for here? What are you achieving here? Let's see what they have paid for with the prosecutor. He incurred that age and gender discrimination lawsuit for women who sued. And
that was about $1 million.
Well, the whole thing, I think, was like $3 million. It came out of various pots, but it was all taxpayer money. You know, the risk pool is still taxpayer money. So there was a lot of money that went out because he has apparently an issue with older women. And so now the Lange lawsuit, $500,000, plus all the legal fees that were associated with the 2 lawsuits. You know, there was one that went to the appeals court and back.
Was it ever decided who...
And then there's the Fager case, of course.
Oh, that's the OpNet case where the...
Where they actually, the county ended up paying the attorney's fees for the other side. So not only for our own side, you know, incurred again by Prosecutor Nichols and Sheriff Benedict, we ended up paying the attorney's fees for the other side. Not a good start.
Well, now let's bring the viewers in with us. The Fager case was with an OpNet case where the county attempted to, under the civil asset forfeiture law, they attempted to take a $500,000 property from the Fager brothers because they were growing, I think, 96 marijuana plants there for medical marijuana patients. And this went through the courts for 3 or 4 or 5 opinions, and they finally decided that the Fager brothers needed to be paid for their legal fees up to $300,000. So, and that has, I don't know if that's been paid out yet or not, but I know it has been ordered by the court to be paid. And now the Fagers have a $20 million lawsuit in federal court for this same issue. So do you think we have problems at the county?
Well, I told Commissioner Johnson today about the Fager case. He had not heard about it yet.
And what, did he have any opinion? Well, I'm not going to ask you to go into
so
that.
So yes, we have some serious problems at the county. Serious, serious structural problems at the county. And I feel, you know, I am just, I'm in way too vulnerable position, and I seem to be the only one who ever, you know, and every time I stand up and object to something, I get, you know, retaliated and smacked down.
Through the magic of television, we're going to anoint you county commissioner for the day. What are you going to do today?
I'm going to fire Jim Jones.
It didn't take you long to think about that. You fired Jim Jones and the replacement. What is going to be different with this new one that you're going to hire?
Well,
hold on to that. We're going to take another break, and we'll be right back. And she's going to tell us what to look for if we needed a new county administrator. We'll be right back with more of Now You Know. Hello and welcome back to Now You Know. I'm your host, Dale Wilson. Our special guest today is Clallam County Treasurer Selinda Barkuis. And before we went to break, we were doing a little play-acting thing. We have made Selinda the commissioner, county commissioner for a day, and it didn't take her long to decide her first act as county commissioner of the day would be to fire the county administrator. Now, we're asking her what would she like to have in the replacement county administrator. So tell us what you would like to have in the new county administrator.
Well, somebody who would be able to accurately interpret law, in fact. What needs to be done as county administrator is to really, in my opinion, is a person that is responsible for ensuring that the public process of the commissioners is occurring appropriately. All of those I's are dotted and T's are crossed. There is a lot of requirements under the Open Public Meeting Act and under the Budgeting Act that those processes are done correctly, because that is what the taxpayers are paying for, is public process and the production of public records that show how every dime is spent. That is what they're entitled to. And at this county, it's the exact opposite that's taking place. And Jim Jones seems to be, in any event, the process, if the process is done correctly, will provide the transparency and accountability, and then the people can make up their own minds as to what they like and not like. And so that transparency is very important to me, and that accountability. And I think that's very important for a county administrator to make sure that that happens.
Now, as a county administrator, let me back up and say this. Because two become a quorum at the county commission, two out of three is a majority, so they can never talk to each other outside of the county commission meetings. Is that correct?
That is the case.
So the county administrator can talk to each of them and have a serial type meeting.
Yes, and so that is basically what he does all day, is just whisper in their ears. And then, you know, and I'm trying to do my job, and I'm always trying to figure out what is the misinformation, disinformation that I need to correct.
Well, do you find that the commissioners are lacking information to make decisions?
I think they are being disinformed and misinformed constantly.
And what is the end game with that?
Well, then they will make decisions based on incorrect information, and that will mean they will make incorrect decisions.
So do you think that Jim Jones has an agenda of some sort that we don't know about?
Oh, yeah, he's got agendas.
Okay. With these, you're still commissioner for a day. What are some other issues in the county that you would like to address or to take a look at?
For sure, the pay parity issue. There's been, over the last few years, there's been a lot of disparity created between employees that used to be paid for the same job classification, same range, same
hourly. So there are certain classifications
hourly.
That go across
yes,
all this county
right,
department.
Exactly. But as of the last union negotiations 4 years ago, some unions, so the sheriff was exempted, the sheriff's administrative staff, talking about administrative staff having the same job classifications as my staff, were a disparity was created, so that now my staff with the same classification, used to be paid the same hourly rate, is now making $1.77 an hour less than the same classification in the sheriff's office. I think that is very, very wrong.
So that would make everybody want to jump to the sheriff's office.
Absolutely. A pay disparity that's been created. That's just one example of it. I think there's other examples.
Now, that was one through union negotiation, right?
So it's there were these union negotiations. So this one group of people was exempted. But they paid, during that year, they paid $250,000 to this Oregon law firm to achieve these results. So they achieved these, in my opinion, pay disparity results with the use of $500,000 in attorney's fees.
Okay, now we have, I think the last time I checked, we spend about $500,000 a day for public safety, law enforcement, criminal justice on the peninsula here. And now you're telling me that we spend how much outside in an Oregon law firm?
Yes, well, 4 years ago, to achieve these disparate pay results, it was $250,000 for that 1 year for this one law firm in Oregon.
Why do they outsource legal work when they have
a multi-million dollar county attorney?
Because
the prosecuting attorney, and he just did that because this is another year where we have union negotiations, and the prosecuting attorney just went on record a couple of weeks ago and said, I want nothing to do with it. So this is forcing the commissioners then to hire outside. So the prosecutor is basically refusing to do this part of his job.
So if you were to refuse to do part of your job, how long would that last?
I'd get sued.
So, in other words, if anything that the county prosecutor doesn't want to do, he can just outsource it to another
law
firm?
Well, that seems to be the case. And, you know, it's really amazing to me how much money is being spent on lawyers and claims and outside lawyers and giving the prosecutor everything he wants. And amazingly enough, a lot of that money is being spent to keep me quiet, to shut me up, to redact my emails, to trump me, to sue me. And this is, you know, enough is enough.
So do you think that it is because you are who you are, because you're a woman, because you don't play ball? What do you think all this is about?
Well, if I had to psychoanalyze, I think he's just threatened by me and perhaps felt the need to, you know, maybe, I don't know, ask the prosecutor. I would be very interested in the answer to that question. I don't know. And frankly, I still have troubles with the fact because, you know, when Mark Nichols was reelected, I actually shook his hand. And I did not know at that point that he had been doing all that stuff against, you know, my work product for all those years. And I still have troubles. You know, my focus has always been on the county administrator, as you know. And it's been it's been difficult to accept that there's the prosecutor who's very, very much had an agenda against me for a long time now, 10 years.
Isn't it safe to say that the county prospers when all the different departments that are paid by taxpayer money work together for a common cause?
Yeah, well, and that is, we're back to the county administrator. His mode of operandi is definitely to pit people up against each other. It's to divide and conquer. That's how he operates. He sends out emails and rile up the people and, you know, pits people out against each other and always yanking the, oh, we're going to have layoffs, oh, we're going to cut, you know.
So it's like intimidation and fear is the way that he prefers to motivate his people?
Yes, there is a lot of intimidation and fear in the courthouse from a number of people that operate in that way. Intimidation and fear. Uh-huh. Being threatened, being sued, that's intimidation. Being threatened with criminal allegations and lawsuits and far-reaching professional financial ramifications and personal liability, that is intimidation.
When you go to work in the courthouse, I'm sure you're told that you have an attorney to protect you and advise you, and that is your county attorney. But now when your county attorney sues you and they will not give you an attorney to defend you,
right. That's
a very lonesome feeling, I bet.
Well, it is. And so now I have a deputy prosecuting attorney who actually was appointed to sue me over the warrants, but I bailed before that happened. Well, now he's my assigned attorney, and I found myself in the extreme surreal experience of sending him an email that said, well, if you're going to act as my deputy prosecuting attorney, you're going to have to promise me not to sue me. could you commit to me in writing that you won't sue me while you're acting as my attorney? And he dutifully wrote back and says, yeah, I promise not to sue you.
But
that makes me feel so much better since you're my attorney.
But could you get that same letter from everybody in that office to, of course, that's not going to happen. Well, Selinda,
but it was my previous own deputy prosecuting attorney that sued me. Yes, any event.
Selinda, as just a taxpayer out here, I want to apologize to you for what you have gone through. I think you've done a wonderful job in attempting to keep the taxpayer funds safe and where they belong. And I don't see your personal, I have not been able to detect a personal agenda that you might be doing except to try to do the right thing for the taxpayers' money. So I just want to thank you. And I know we're going to be sad to lose you. And I hope whomever they bring in, you will give them a full accounting for what to expect so that they won't get blindsided.
Absolutely. I will explain to them in detail what they're taking on because they will have to be prepared.
Well, if you decide to leave the office, as I'm sure you will, I hope we'll get in another opportunity to come in and tell us more of the palace intrigue going on at the Clallam County Courthouse.
Absolutely. Thank you for having me.
Folks, that's it for another edition of Now You Know. I'm your host, Dale Wilson. Today we have a very special guest and some breaking news with Selinda Barkuis, who is a most revealing interview today, and I'm sure that you'll be hearing more of it. So do check back in at Peninsula Area Public Access for more of Now You Know. From your host, Dale Wilson, have a great afternoon.